Yes, God! Whatever it is, whatever you require, God, I'll give it all. I'll give it all.
Yes,
Lord. Oh, the glory of God. Oh, the glory of God. Oh, the glory of God. You know, God's glory manifests. It manifests when he wants to sup with you. When he wants to change you. The glory of God manifests when he wants to anoint you. Describe what that means is when he wants that intimate time with you. It's like he wants to make love with his bride. When you prepare an atmosphere of willingness and obedience for the glory of God, and that's all that he wants, he will manifest. And he will speak to you, and things will happen in the glory of God. Things will happen in the glory of God. Sometimes things that you've been trying to change in yourself for years. Just one moment in the glory of God. Just one touch from the presence of God. And it's gone. Moses came down from the mountain. was straight up shining with the glory of God. His face was shining. It was evident that he had been in the presence of God. It was evident that he had been in the anointing of God. It was evident that the glory had come and overtaken the person of himself and was shining through him. And you know what happened? It freaked some people right the heck on out. It freaked him out. So much so that he had to put a veil over his face. When you've been in the glory of God, that's just what happens. So some people might be freaked out right now. I don't know. Hallelujah. But you know what? Even though they were afraid of what they were seeing on Moses' face, that glory had influence over them. That glory set the standard. And when Moses came down, even though they were freaked out with the glory, they opened up and he began to tell them what the Lord said and what the Lord required, right? In 2 Corinthians 3, 7, it says, but if the ministry of death, written and engraved on stones, was glorious.
I mean, it was glorious.
It was so glorious that his face shone. It was glorious. It was super glorious, right? But check this out. If the ministry of death, written and engraved on stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not look at the face of Moses because of the glory of his countenance, which glory was passing away, how will the ministry of the Spirit, where we are now, not be more glorious? And some scripture, translations say much more glorious. Much more glorious. Much more glorious than a shining face that was freaking people right on out. I don't know about you, but if somebody came in here with a face that was shining, like literally with light, I might be freaked out a little bit. You know what I mean? But much more glorious. Much more glorious. Ha! Much more. Hallelujah. And I looked up that word much, and it means largely, altogether, far past. And more means better, more and more glorious. So this, what we're in now, is altogether better. It's largely more and more. Largely more and more glorious that we have available to us today. And I don't know, man. I mean, it's like, I don't know what it is. I mean, from the time I gave my heart to the Lord, I don't know. That's just something that it's, for me, it's like, I'm in the glory. That's it. I'm in the glory. I want to see Jesus. I'm in the glory. That's it, you know? And that's how it is. It's available like that. Some people try to work and toil and be good enough in their song and their dance and whatever. And that's not it. That's not it. It's the fire of God.
Yes.
It's the glory of God. And it's as simple as saying, yes, God.
Yes.
Here I am again. I love you still. Whatever you require.
Amen.
That's it. Yes. That's the glory of God. That's entering into the glory of God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Jesus. And the glory of God is, it's the heavy, weighty goodness of God. It's heavy and it's weighty, but it doesn't imply anything bad. It only means the heavy and weighty good things. The heavy and weighty good things from God. He's just waiting there to give those things to us in his glory. But let me tell you, That doesn't happen without you going there. And I'm not talking about, you know, yes, we're in this body. We've been born again. We're a new creature in Christ Jesus. All old things have passed away. All things have become new. We live this new life in Christ, right? And we know that the presence of God is always with us. We know that the Spirit of God dwells within us and that we can tap in and there's that availability, right? And I recognize that. But I'm talking about getting in that secret place with God. I'm talking about getting in the chamber room with the Lord. Into the glory of God, right? And the Lord is just showing me that this weekend, and he's speaking that to this church.
Come on.
God's doing something big here. We all know that. We can see it. Man, Josh and I were just talking about it last night. It's like, no, I don't see this as a little thing. I honestly really don't. I've been to places where the Spirit of God is moving, where major revival is happening, right? I mean, if any of you have been to the river at Tampa Bay, the Spirit of God is heavy there. I mean, it's God's doing something, but it's no more than what God's doing here.
Yeah.
I've been in revival meeting after revival meeting after revival meeting, and God is doing something new in this place. He's doing something fresh in this place. And I have been so lost in the presence of God right here in these seats in this last 2 years than I've ever been in my life. Ever been in my life. And it's the glory. And it's available. But let me tell you something. Stuff happens when you get in the glory of God. And sometimes when stuff happens, you know, way back when you got in the glory, it may freak you out a little bit and make people hesitant to go back to that same place because they're afraid. Because, let's actually just go there and read this really quick. Let's go to Exodus 24. Actually, Exodus 25. So before we read, I'm just going to kind of give you guys a rundown of what's going on. Basically, right before this is when, you know, the children of Israel said, yes, whatever the Lord requires, that's what we'll do. And, you know, kind of created an environment for the glory of God to come. And then Moses, you know, did what he did some, you know, sacrifices and offerings and stuff. And then the glory of God showed up. The glory of God manifested. And so then Moses went up on the hill. You know, like I said, it was like a pillar of fire. Everybody saw this pillar of fire. And now you have to know, when you go in the glory of God, it's fire.
Yeah.
And it's going to burn stuff out of you. Right? It's going to do it. But Moses, and even though Moses knew that, he chose to go anyways. Don't ever be afraid of what the fire can do to you.
Yes.
The only thing that will make you afraid of what the fire can do to you is your flesh.
Yeah.
You're stinking thinking, oh, I don't want to do that because then I'll have to give up this, and this, right?
Yeah.
Oh, I can't go there because I know I'm doing this, and this wrong, and God might put a stinger on that, right? Don't ever do that.
Yes.
When you do that, you're cutting yourself off from the glory of God in you.
Right.
You're cutting yourself off.
Yeah.
You know? Okay. So they're going up and the glory of God manifests. And Moses makes the choice to go up on the hill. He wants to hear what God has to say. He knows he's going to get a download from the Lord, right? Check this out. Chapter 25, verse 1. He was up there for 40 days and 40 nights. And it says, then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel that they bring me an offering. From everyone who gives it willingly with his heart, you shall take my offering. Willingly.
Yeah.
Willingly.
Yes.
Whoever gives willingly. Okay? And this is the offering which you shall take from them. Gold, silver, and bronze. Wait, what? You want my gold? You want my silver and my bronze? Oh, wait, hold on a second. Blue, purple, and scarlet thread, fine linens and goat hairs, ram skins, dyed red, badger skins, and acacia wood, oil for the light and spices for the anointing oil and for the sweet incense. Oh, you want all that too?
Yeah.
Onyx stones and stones to be set in the ephod and in the breastplate, and let them make a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. Now some people stepped into the glory and they heard the first sentence and said, whoa, come right on back out of that. You want what from me? Oh, you want my everything? You want my heart? You want everything that's dear and precious to me? Wait a minute. Right? How many have done that before? Or how many know that you've seen people do that before? Right? The first thing that he said to Moses when Moses was in his glory wasn't, I love you. It wasn't, I have such big plans for your life. It wasn't, you're going to be a mighty man of God. He said, I want an offering.
Yeah.
And I want it all.
Yeah.
I want it big.
Yeah.
I don't want it small. Right?
Yeah.
Uh-oh. Freaking people out here. This is the word. This is what the word says, right? And let them make me a sanctuary, that I may dwell among them, according to all that I show you, that is the pattern of the tabernacle. Okay, so I'm gonna skip over all that part, but basically he's describing the Ark of the Testimony and the tabernacle. He's saying all these different things that he wants, and I actually talked about that one time. But when you're in the glory, God makes his requirements of you known to you. He starts telling you, this is what I want. I want this and this and this. And back then, what he wanted was all these great possessions of theirs. And yes, it was monetarily valuable, but it was where their heart's treasure was, right? Which is really what he wants, our heart's treasure. Right? But he was very specific. I'll just let you guys read it at some point on your own. But if you go down through the rest of 25 and through 26, where he describes what he wants in the tabernacle and stuff, he is very specific about what he wants. He wants, like, I mean, part of it said, let me find it, because I'm... Okay, here we go. Just over here in chapter 26, it says in verse 9, and you shall couple 5 curtains by themselves and 6 curtains by themselves, and you shall double over the 6th curtain at the forefront of the tent. You shall make 50 loops on each edge of the curtain that is the outermost one set, and then 50 loops on the edge of the curtain of the second set, and you shall make 50 bronze clasps and put the clasps into the loops, and you can go on and on and on and on, right? But he was specific. And I ministered on that one time, and I said, Lord, why were you so specific about exactly what you wanted? And he spoke in my spirit and said, because I wanted to see if they would obey me to the jot and tittle. Every last requirement that he had for them, he wanted fulfilled. Not 49 loops, not 51 loops. He wanted 50 loops on that curtain, right?
Yeah.
Same thing today, in this greater glory. He's going to speak to you exactly what he wants from you. Exactly what he wants from you. And then it's up to you to obey. So first in the glory, his requirements are made. Secondly, they're very specific. He won't leave you confused. He won't leave you questioning whether it was him speaking to you. When you hear what the Lord has to say to you in the glory, you can walk out in faith and know that he's told you to do that, right? And you can be obedient. The next thing, or one of the next things that happens in the glory, is he teaches humility. He teaches honor in the glory. I'm going to just read, if you go over to Exodus 28. I'm not going to read every single you know, the whole chapter. I'm just going to read a couple of little places that stand out. But I really encourage you guys, if you want to really get a download from the Holy Ghost about the glory of God, this is a really good place to see it. It says in chapter 28, verse 1. Now take Aaron, your brother, and his sons with him from among the children of Israel, that he may minister to me as priest, Aaron, and Aaron's sons. So and so and so and so and so and so. And you shall make holy garments for Aaron, your brother, for glory and for beauty. So you shall speak to all who are gifted artisans, whom I have filled with the spirit of wisdom, that they make Aaron's garments to consecrate him, that he may minister to me as priest. So in the glory, he wanted to anoint. He was anointing Aaron as the first priest, right? And Moses was his brother. Now, I don't know about you guys, but with my brother, we kind of have this kind of, you know, goofy relationship. But the Lord was showing Moses that he was going to honor his brother. He asked him to go out and speak to all the great artisans. You know, he was going out there speaking to them regarding his brother in a place of honor, in a place of humility, speaking only good things about his brother, not speaking garbage, right? He was showing him honor. And they honored his sons too. You know, it was like the whole family. They honored the whole family. So God was just showing me that, and Pastor Jason and Hannah aren't here, but that just really spoke to me about honoring our pastors. In the glory, God will tell us to honor our pastors and to honor the office that they stand in. Amen?
Yes.
That's the truth. And, you know, yeah, some of us, maybe they're kind of like our brother, so to say. I mean, Josh and I have been friends with them for a very long time, but you won't ever hear me call them by their name without the name pastor in front of it.
Amen.
Because I honor them.
Amen.
I won't do it, right? Because that's a place of honor.
Yes, amen.
It's a place of honor. Hallelujah. God will teach that in the glory. He will teach that in his presence by his spirit. Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah. Jesus.
Ha ha. You know what else happens in the glory? Is dead things come to life in the glory. Dead things come to life. Let's just read that in John 11:38. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for your glory. Thank you, Lord, for your glory. Jesus. Verse 38 says, then Jesus, again groaning in himself, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. Actually, I'm going to back up. Oh, no, I'm not. Okay, never mind. And a stone lay against it, and Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of him who was dead, said to him, Lord, by this time there is such a stench, for he has been dead for 4 days. And Jesus said to her, did I not say that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God? The glory of God.
Come on.
Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead man was laying. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. And I know that you always hear me, but because of the people who are standing by, I say this, that they may believe that you sent me. And now when he said these things, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he who had died came out bound, hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, loose him and let them go. Let him go. That was the manifest glory of God And sometimes things happen in your life where maybe you had life in some areas. You had life in your relationship with the Lord. You had life in your ministry. You had life in your business. You had life in your relationships with people. You had life in the call of God on your life. You had life in these areas. But over time, junk got in, stuff happened, whatever, pile, right down in there. And now it's dead. But in the glory, if you just believe, if you would just believe in the glory, it can come back to life. Whatever it is. Business, come forth. Love, come forth. Anointing, come forth. Call of God, come forth. Gifts of the Spirit, come forth. Back to life in Jesus' name. It's the glory. It's the glory of God. And we don't take it lightly. We don't take it lightly, and it's not just for Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights. We should live in the glory. Live in the glory of God. It's available. It's available even greater than it was before. It's available. I don't know. I still think back, man. Sometimes we just have to stir ourselves up. And I tell myself that if for one second I start to struggle in, you know, entering in worship, I just start to stir it up. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Lord, I remember where I was. Oh, I remember how I was dead and I was on my way to death, hell, and the grave. Oh, I remember. And I stir it up. And I stir it up. And even this morning, oh, I remembered. I stirred myself up by reminding myself of the first touch.
Oh,
the first touch in the glory of God. And there's nothing better. Oh, there's nothing better. It was 17 years ago, and I was in a Holy Ghost meeting, and man, the presence of God was so heavy, so weighty, so good, thick. And I had just given my heart to the Lord, and I remember just crying out and just, God, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry for what I've done and the life that I've lived and just forsaking you and not serving you. And I, you know, kind of went through this, you know, reliving my life and all these things in my life and, you know, drugs and overdoses and all this stuff. And one time I almost died. And I remembered that moment in my heart that time 17 years ago. And I just said, thank you so much, God. I could have died. I could have died in my sin. I was in the hospital. I was dying. They told my mom, she won't live through the night. She's going to die. Go say goodbye. And I cried out to God that night. And I just said, thank you. Thank you, Lord. And you know what he said to me? I kept you. I kept you. And that was the first touch that I received in the glory. That was the first touch. And I will never forget that. I will never take that lightly. And I'm here to tell you that that same glory, that same deep, thick presence of God is available every day.
Amen.
Why not live there? Why not live there? Right? Oh, he's so good. And he kept you. He kept every single one of you. I share my word with you this morning. Jesus. And you know what? Since that time, every time, I mean, you can't go into the glory. You can't press into the glory and get on your face before the presence of God and see all of his good things come and pass by you and be angry.
Yeah.
You can't do that. You to you that if you're struggling with those things, and I've been there, but if you're struggling with those things, if you're struggling with woe is me, depression, fear, oppression, anxiety, depression, sadness, defeat, any of that, I dare say, you better get in the glory of God. And you better get there with a willing heart, willing to do whatever the Lord says, whatever He requires of you. Hallelujah. There's true joy. There's true and lasting joy in the presence of God. The deep joy. The joy that comes from here. That bubbles up out of your belly. That your circumstances can't change. That the devil can't still. That depression can't overtake. Because it's come from the glory. And the glory influences the surroundings that is around it. Right? When Moses came out. When Moses came out of the glory. The children of Israel's fear didn't have anything to do on him. The glory that was on him, the manifest glory, influenced his surroundings, right? And when you're full of the glory, though everything comes pressing from each side, doesn't matter. Because the glory of God that's in you, the revelation, the rhema word that was spoken to you, the Holy Ghost surgery that happened in you, that takes precedence over every situation, over every circumstance, over every fiery dart of the wicked one that he could send your way.
That's right.
Right?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Jesus. Psalms 126:1 says, when the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, when he said, I kept you, Amanda. I kept you for my purpose. I kept you for my call. I kept you for my will. When he brought me back, hallelujah. When the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, we were like those who dream. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus. Have you ever had something so good happen to you that it just feels like, am I dreaming?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
When I had Noah, I remember I gave birth to Noah and they put him on my chest and it was so good. I literally felt like, and I said to Josh, is this real? Am I dreaming? I felt like I was dreaming. It was so good. It was so good. Right? Then our mouth was filled with laughter. Ha! And our tongue with singing. And they said among the nations. They said among the nations. That's us. That's our job. They said among the nations. They said in the grocery store. They said at the gas station. They said at their job. They said at the park. They said while they were driving down the road. They said in the nations. Right?
Yeah.
They said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us. And we are glad.
Yeah.
Oh, hallelujah. When you've been in the glory of God, when you've seen the presence in the face of God, and it's real to you. Oh, you're glad.
Yeah.
You know what he brought you out from.
Yeah.
You know how good he is. You know the captivity that you were in. And you know the freedom that you now have.
Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Jesus. And there's joy. There's joy in that. Real, true joy. The fruit of the Spirit. And joy is something you live. Joy is something you act out. Joy is something that people see.
Right.
They see it on your face. They see it in your... Nope, not just in church on Sunday. Not just in church on Wednesday. Nuh-uh. When you're at home throughout the week and your husband's driving you crazy. When your kids are running around and won't be quiet or whatever. right? That joy, that true joy that came from the glory of God, that joy should still be there. And if it's not, get in the glory. Get in the glory. Simple as that. I mean, it's not this hard thing, like, oh, I'm really struggling, I've been struggling with this and this and this and this. What? For how long? I mean, 5 minutes? 10 minutes? 2 years? Come on now. We're saints of God. We are people of God with access to the anointing and the glory of God. If you had a disease and you were dying and you were on your deathbed and there was a medication right next to you that you knew would heal you, would you take it?
Amen.
Probably, right? I mean, I'm saying that in a natural aspect. I'm not saying that in a faithless, we know God's our healer, But you know what I'm saying? A lot of people in this world don't have the same access where they're living right now. Come on now. We have that access to the glory of God. Why do we want to sit there for 2 weeks struggling with being depressed?
Yeah.
Do you want to? Come on. Maybe just because you don't know. Well, here I am to tell you, you don't have to.
Yeah.
You don't have to anymore. From today, July 24th, 2016, you don't have to.
That's right.
You don't have to live like that. In fact, you're not called to live like that. In fact, you're not made to live like that. That's why God says, cast all my cares on me, or all your cares on me, for I care for you. He doesn't want you to live like that. He doesn't want you to live in that garbage.
Peace.
But the answer, that medication bottle, it's in the glory. It's in the glory of God. Does that mean that we have to take that time to shut everything off? Get in that quiet place with the Lord. Maybe it's not a quiet place. I'm not saying it has to be quiet, because sometimes you just shout and whatever. Totally been there lots of times. But you know what I'm saying, that chamber room with the Lord.
Yeah.
And that's what a relationship is. I love my husband, and I love spending time with him, and I love going places with him, and I love talking with him, and I love looking at him. He's something good looking, I like to look on his face, and he gives me good advice. Sometimes there's times when I just need a husband to talk to, and I'll talk to him, and he'll give me good advice, right?
Yeah, that's good.
I love him. Well, it's the same thing with God.
Yeah.
Why do we struggle with that? Why do people struggle with that? It's so easy to spend time with people right here that you see in your face that you love. But God, the creator of your very self, the one who gives you the breath every morning when you wake up, the one who loves you with a deeper love than your husband or wife could ever love you with. Why do we find such a struggle to go into that secret place and spend time with him? Well, I know that when you do, when you become familiar with the glory, when you just start doing it and you see, you taste and you see how good God is, you won't struggle like that anymore. You'll hunger.
Yes.
Your hunger will increase.
Yeah.
Your desire will increase. Right?
Yeah.
And you'll be full. You'll be full. You'll be full of the things of God. When I come into prayer or worship or whatever, we should be so full already with the things of God that it's just one drop, and we're overflowing, right? Sometimes it's like we get lower, we're getting emptier, and then you've got to pray, and you've got to push through for like 45 minutes just to get to the full brink part, right? And then, prayer's over, But when you stay in the glory, when you stay in the presence of God, and you allow him to do what he wants to do, and you stay full, that first whole rub I've had, I go, whoa, I'm overflowing.
Amen.
I'm overflowing. Worship's happening. Oh, Jesus. Oh, I thank you again. Oh, I love you again, and I'm here again, Lord. some people in their hearts are saying, I don't know how to do this. Listen, you just do it.
Come on.
Amen.
You just do it.
Right.
Who shall ascend into the hill of God? Him who has clean hands and a pure heart. Okay, let's go there. Him who has clean hands and a pure heart. This is the same thing if you're dealing with sin in your life. I'm not saying anybody here is, but I'm feeling the Holy Ghost leading me in this direction. This is the same thing if you're dealing with sin in your life. You don't have to deal with it for 2 years. You don't have to deal with it for 2 months. You don't have to. It's as simple as one decision.
Yes.
To say, no, whatever the Lord asks of me or requires of me, I will do it. That is what we're called to be. We are called to be holy because He is holy.
Amen.
That means saying no to your flesh. That means when your flesh tries to rise up and say, ooh, let's do that. That looks fun. Your spirit man says, get down. No, we're not doing that. We're called to be holy because God is holy. And if you haven't been doing that, I'm not condemning you. I'm saying right now, today. Today is the day. You don't have to go on from this day forward living like that. The glory of God is available. That medication bottle for that disease is available.
Yeah.
It's as simple as saying, God, I've been doing this. I know it's not right. I don't want to do it anymore. I want to be pleasing to you. I want to live in your glory. And here I am. Here I am. Right? Hallelujah. Jesus. Hallelujah. Okay. Check this out. John 12. Chapter 12, verse 1. Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Verse 1 says, then 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus was who had been dead, whom he had raised from the dead. There they made him a supper, and Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those who sat at the table with him. Then Mary took a pound of very costly oil of spikenard, anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the fragrance of oil. Hallelujah. See, Mary, if you remember just a little bit back, we talked about Lazarus being raised from the dead, and that happened before this, right? See, Mary had seen the glory of God. Mary saw what the glory of God could do. She saw that it had life-giving power. She saw the anointing in the glory of God.
Amen.
And do you know what it made her want to do? Give.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I heard somebody say this recently. Man, it just stuck with me. And then Brother Shane played the song this morning. But it was, that song. When I think about Jesus and what he's done for me, I want to dance. Right, and this person was saying, yeah, they've been to these churches that sing that, and they'll come up with like 20 different verses, you know. I want to twist. I want to jump. And they'll go on for like an hour with the same song, right? But never once did she hear, I want to give all night, right? I don't know about you, but when I get in the glory of God, I'm looking around. What do I got? What do I got? What can I give? I mean, my shoes, you know. Usually it's money, but I mean, there's been times when I don't have money, and it's whatever, right?
Yeah, that's right.
She saw the glory of God. She saw the glory of God manifest. She saw what the glory of God can do. And she had a heart to give. She had a heart to give to God.
Amen.
And she, you know, another translation says she broke that alabaster box above his head. And now the Lord was showing me last night, a lot of times, you know, people talk about the costly oil that was in it, right? And it was costly. It was worth like a year's wages, right? That's a lot of money. And she just broke it. She broke it right above his head. And the oil just poured over him. But you know, that alabaster box was also very costly. Very costly. And I get interested in these kinds of things. And I looked into it last night. And alabaster is very rare, first of all. But the first 6 feet, and alabaster is mined from the ground. And the first 6 feet of alabaster that's mined, it's worthless. You can't use it because it's brittle and it's not translucent enough and whatever. I mean, maybe some people use it for less costly things, but for the costly things, you gotta dig deep. It's between 6 and 20 feet in the ground that the good alabaster comes from, right? So this alabaster box, she dug, it's like the Lord was showing me, she dug deep. She dug deep. And the glory of God impressed upon her heart to give. Amen?
Yes.
Hallelujah. And so when God made that requirement in the very beginning, when Moses went up there and he said, this is what I require of you. I require this and this and this and this and this. Right? All these offerings. But today he requires our heart. He requires us to break the alabaster box of our heart.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He wants our hearts, our treasures to be where our heart is, our heart to be where our treasure is, right? In the true riches, because we know that the true riches are in the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus. The glory of God. The glory of God. It's the glory of God that sets man free. It's the glory of God that changes you. It's the glory of God. Hallelujah. Jesus. 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 And you know, as she poured that oil over him, and it ran down him and down to his feet. And she took her hair and she wiped his feet with her hair. She began to smell like Jesus. She began to smell like Jesus. She poured her heart out to him. She gave him her all. And God honored that. God honored that. Hallelujah. Jesus. So I just want to encourage you this morning. Get hungry. Get hungrier. You know, when we have meetings like we're having, you know, you can go home and feel like, oh, that was so good. That was so good. And God's changing me so much. And that's so true. But even more, deeper wells. Deeper wells. Get hungrier. Get thirstier. Get more desperate for the things of God.
Yes.
You know, God's been waking me up in the morning. I mean, I'm so hungry for God. I'm so desperate for God that he's waking me up in the morning and speaking to my heart and just telling me intimate things. You know, just being hungry for God. Nothing else more important. Nothing else more important than seeing his face. Than getting in the fire. Getting in the fire. Amen. Hallelujah. Jesus. Hallelujah. Alan, can you play that last song again? Just the Holy Ghost music. Jesus. Hallelujah. changes things. The glory of God changes your heart. Mold you into exactly what He wants for you. Exactly what He's called you to be. The glory of God. Oh, the glory of God. Oh, we thank You for Your glory, Lord. Oh, we thank You for Your glory, God. Maybe some of you in here, you've not been entering glory like I talked about today. You just need your gaskets blown out.
Yeah.
You just need a glorious cleanse. And you say, yes, I want that. Yes, I want that glory that You're talking about. I want to go into that chamber room.
Yeah.
I'm ready. I'm ready to just give it all.
Yeah.
I'm ready to be like the children of Israel that says, whatever. Whatever You ask, Lord. Whatever the word of the Lord is, we will do it. Maybe that's you this morning.